Detective David Kemp saw his partner's hand trembling as he lifted the whiskey glass and drank down a shot. The guy's face was still pale as the moon. Seeing his partner so greatly shaken before him made him think, yep, he's not ever going back down in that basement again. Country music played from the juke in the lonely, shadowy bar. The detectives found a corner booth to sit. The only other patron was a woman sitting on a stool across the way. She leaned over, gazing hopelessly into a glass of beer, as if an answer to some serious problem might pop up in there.
"Have you ever come across a scene like that one before, David?"
his partner, Adam Harper, said.
David shook his head. "No," he said. Detective Kemp had worked 20 years on the force, and he had come across some bizarre scenes over the years.
Yet the one they found that morning in the basement of the abandoned manufacturing factory topped them all. What the hell could have done that to the guy's head, Dave?
"How about a nut job with an axe?" David said, and bent his arms and legs like a freakish human pretzel.
Adam still trembled. He shifted awkwardly in the booth, as if he couldn't get comfortable. Maybe the nut job was a chiropractic specialist.
David tried to joke, a thin grin on his face, but Adam wasn't having it. He gazed at David sternly.
"Hey, it was probably more than one. The cartel carries out murders like that all the time. This guy was homeless. The cartel's cruel."
Adam reached up to the collar of his shirt, wincing.
"Let's not forget this." He pulled down the collar of his shirt, exposing the jagged red scratch along the lower neck and shoulder. "Whatever it was, it attacked me. We don't know that. You could have scraped your shoulder against a nail in the wall."
"I wasn't up against a wall. Something might have fallen from the ceiling."
"Bullshit, David." Adam glared at David with incredulity. "I'm not going down there again. I know you're not."
David grabbed a small handful of nuts from the complimentary tray and popped them into his mouth.
"We ain't solving this case. It's sad. A poor homeless guy died being in the wrong place at the wrong time, and we ain't ever gonna catch the perpetrator."
Adam lightly pounded his hands on the dark wood of the table with emphasis as he spoke. The song on the juke changed, this time the sound of Elvis Presley's crooning voice.
"We ain't ever gonna catch him, because it wasn't some psycho with an axe or the work of some gang members of the cartel. It was a devil, David. Devils did that to him. Bent him all up like that and split his face open. Devils. That's what scratched my shoulder, too."
The guy has lost his mind, David thought. Anyone, of course, could reach their breaking point. Some had thicker skin is all. One skin had to be like armor to do this work. Others, they just couldn't handle it. Adam wouldn't be going back down in that room again. And most likely, in a couple years, he probably wouldn't be carrying the badge anymore either.
Adam leaned back in the booth, sighing and rubbing his shoulder.
"Look, Adam, I'm sorry about the joke. That's just part of what helps me get through it all. It was a terrible scene down there. I can't explain what happened. Devils, entities, I just can't believe that. Our job is to find a better reason. You and Gina ought to go up to the lake for a week. Take a vacation."
"Don't mind if I do," Adam said. Then he pointed at David. "If you had any sense, you'd stay the hell out of there too."
David had nothing to say. Adam walked away. David finished his drink.
Wrong place at the wrong time. That was the nutshell description of every murder scene ever investigated. Mr. Jacob Walker, age 35, had definitely found himself in that situation. The guy had one time been a bank teller. He'd even been married. Somewhere along the way, he fell on hard times. Lost his job, lost his home, and his wife. From past records, it looked like he had been picked up a couple times for other little crimes. Shoplifting, some drug charges. Detective Kemp figured somebody had it out for him.
and the killers decided to be a bit more creative in how they killed him, not the quick bullet to the head. Detective Kemp returned to the room in the basement where the body had been found. He needed to know. Surely there was some explanation for the scratch on Adam's shoulder, not some ridiculous idea of entities or devils. Photographs were being taken of the crime scene when Adam had suddenly hissed in pain near the stairway, his body straightening and becoming rigid. He bellowed, "Ow! What the hell?" and reached for his shoulder. Detective Kemp thought he was having a heart attack. They rushed up the stairs and back out into the noonday sun. Adam peeled down the collar of his shirt, exposing the nasty, jagged, bloody line in his shoulder. The dank, musty smells of dust, cobwebs, and water assailed his nose as he descended the cracked cement steps using a flashlight. He shone the flashlight beam alongside the old warped bricks of the wall, looking for a protruding nail or something that Adam must have brushed up against at the bottom of the stairs to hurt himself like that. When he reached the bottom of the stairwell, he found nothing that could have truly caused any damage along the wall. He aimed the beam up at the ceiling and found only long strands of cobwebbing and stains in the old ceiling. Something must have fallen, Detective Kemp thought. It fell and got him right on the shoulder. How could that be true, though? There would have been some evidence of an object on the floor, something more significant than mouse droppings and dust. Detective Kemp wanted to deny it, but he couldn't completely deny it. Maybe there was something more to this scene than this simple explanation. It was another homeless man who had found the mangled body of Jacob Walker. Abandoned factories, office buildings, and other places often became makeshift homes for the homeless. This particular room had been a frequent stay for many of them, and the graffiti on the walls showed that. Detective Kemp shone the light along the corners of the walls. Names and squiggly lettering dominated part of one wall. In another section, someone had oddly painted a Jesus figure wielding the cross like a giant battering ram upon the world. Two glowing eyes appeared in the beam of light. A cat had somehow gotten down there. It froze, meowed, and then scattered off in the dark. On the back wall was a painting of a numerous cluster of eyes of all shapes and sizes. Captioned below in black, jagged lettering were these words, "We're watching you." Detective Kemp shone the flashlight beam to the floor, a white chalk line traced where the corpse had been. Amidst the filth on the floor, it looked like a Rorschach ink blot. It did feel like something stranger, something deeper, something darker was at work in this place. Kemp just didn't want to believe it. He had always liked the principle of Occam's razor, and it often seemed to him that the simplest solutions for problems were often true. But not always. The air somehow did seem thicker down here. The air felt galvanized, as though a current of electricity flowed within it. The hair raised on the back of his neck. He felt a cold chill work through him. He shivered. Then he felt a small tug on his jacket. Kemp wheeled around, moving his hand to the holster where a Glock 9mm awaited. The flashlight beam unveiled an old rusty barrel in the corner containing ashy remains in its bottom. He had heard of scenes where satanic rituals had taken place, and the sacrificing of animals. Sometimes even humans were involved in such rituals. Could poor old Jacob Walker have been just that? An offering to the devil, done with reveling deformations and mutilations. Adam's last words before leaving the bar replayed in his mind. If you had any sense, you'd stay the hell out of there too. He turned to walk back to the stairway, and an unseen force knocked the flashlight from his hand. It tumbled to the filthy cement floor and rolled to the corner. Kemp gasped and stepped back, reaching for his gun. "Who's there?" he said. "Show yourself right now. Hands up." Voices, small whispering voices, echoed in the room. "Answer me," Kemp said. They answered him with a hard shove in the back. An invisible force tumbled Kemp to the floor, where he landed hard on his knee. Pain burst up his leg. Whispering voices rose to cackling. Voices of many tones and timbres crackled around him like startling strings of firecrackers. Kemp felt an unseen weight press upon his arms and legs. He thrashed side to side and managed to reach his gun as the forceful grip of the unseen hand caused him to fire off a couple rounds, enormously loud in the small space. He dropped the gun and let out a raspy shriek as stinging pain etched its way through his back. It felt like hot irons were pressing upon the flesh of his lower shoulders. For a brief moment, the weight of the unseen force lessened, and Detective Kemp launched to his feet and began hurrying up the stairs. He pushed upward on all fours, digging frantically with his hands and propelling with his feet. About halfway up the stairway, one of his hands slipped, and his face slammed into the edge of one of the risers, causing a flash of pain to spread throughout his jaw. He felt those unseen hands close around his ankles like steel manacles. He bellowed in horror, reaching, grabbing the upper risers, digging his fingernails painfully into the old cement. The buzzing of voices pierced his eardrums. In that moment, the unseen hands relented, and Kemp launched his body upward, bashing through the doorway into the upper hallway. As he jolted to his feet to run away, he managed to catch a glimpse, a flicker of madness in the stirring darkness of the basement's throat. That darkness was a living, writhing, lunatic assembly of distorted faces and pinching appendages. A high-pitched scream ripped from his body as he ran from the building, not once looking back. Later that day, back at the precinct, Detective Kemp revealed everything that happened to him to Detective Harper, babbling the words in near frantic incoherency, repeating how right he was. He removed his blood-soaked shirt and made a horrifying discovery. The unseen hands had carved a crude cluster of bleeding eyes that gazed out from the flesh of his back.